thrilled for your friend, and Nishrin, whose testimony was something that left me speechless and broke my belief in the idea of India for the second time. The first was 2002 in Gujarat. And thanks also to Professor Anjana Chatterjee. You should have been a poet, you know, but a lot of us are in business. That's so beautiful, even as it was academic. Today, given that the other speakers have spoken about what Gujarat does and the implications of getting justice, as well as the other violence that is visited upon by the RSS on India's minorities, especially in Gujarat and UP and Orissa, I want to talk to what does this Hindutva actually do when it's not attacking a minority? I mean, in the sense of you know, this idea of Hindutva cannot exist you know, in some kind of pure concentrated form without it permeating into broader society, and how does it affect? And so one of the things that we wanted to discuss, and which Dr. Kalpana was talking about, was this idea of the love jihad, or this this whole Hindutva dream, or what you call the scare about Muslim men actually going out, being recruited to fall in love with Hindu girls, lure them into their religion, forcibly convert them, and make them into, you know, vessels to produce more Muslim children, and therefore hide the Muslim population. Or this is not, this is a kind of what the whole love jihad scare is about, and something that is not only taking place in, let's say, the UK or other places where Hindu nationalism is strong, but also, you know, even in progressive places like Kerala, where I work a lot. So you have these posters on bus stands that say, "Be careful of love jihad, girls, be careful." But the fact is that, you know, for a long time, I think since we started hearing about it, let's say 2007, 2008, 2006, it was just love jihad, Muslim men, Hindu women, and, you know, the formula never changed. But surprisingly, in 2012, when you had this incident in Dharmapuri, where one girl of the caste Hindu community of Vanniyars, which is an OBC community, married a man from the Dalit community called Ilavarasan. She was 20, he was 22. And she married Ilavarasan, and this happened in Dharmapuri. And a couple of days after the marriage, you know, violence broke out. Her father was tortured, so he committed suicide. And the Patali Makkal Katchi, or which is one of those feudal caste communities, they basically launched an attack on every single Dalit man who had married an upper caste or a one-year girl. So they chose three Dalit colonies to attack. And in November 2012, on November 7th, if I'm not very bad with the dates, 268 homes of Dalit people were burnt in one single day. So this is Annanagar, Kondapatti, and Natham colony. And these were actually, once upon a time, Naxalite places. You know, these are the kinds of places you would never imagine caste Hindu violence visiting. And these are also places that, being once ex-Naxalite areas, these are manned 24 hours by police personnel. You actually have a check post to enter that. This is Dharmapuri, this is Tamil Nadu, this is not Kashmir, this is not a border area, but these places actually have a 24-hour police check post. And still, these mobs of Vanniyars could come and they could torch the homes. Every single home was torched. Thankfully, there were no casualties because people could run away. They were pleading for help, but there no help was forthcoming. But why I am talking about this incident, so what purely looks from the outside like a caste attack, and caste attacks are extremely routine as far as cultures, you know, as far as at least Tamil Nadu is concerned, by the oppressor caste on the Dalit people, is that the way it was being framed by Ramadas, who runs the Patali Makkal Katchi and others, he was clearly framing it in the language of love jihad. He was saying, these Dalit men are being tutored by the leader of the Dalit party into wearing jeans, into wearing sunglasses, into going around on motorbikes, into, you know, appearing fashionable, and therefore luring women of the caste Hindu, the Vanniyar community. And they're also, you know, targeting only the most educated women. They're targeting women who are wealthy and we are doing all this. So the idea is that, you know, at some point of time we just look at it through this whole prism of religion and think, yeah, it's Hindu versus Muslim versus Christian. And some, I think Hindutva is far more pernicious than that. The rise of the Hindu right wing in some way lets it permeate your language, it permeates discourse, and it modifies everything so that even within Hinduism, or even within so-called Hinduism, it becomes very easy for anybody to, you know, start this kind of a love jihad campaign. He never used the word love jihad, but what he was talking about these Dalit men, about casting them, just as Muslim men were, you know, cast into the role of the other, the demon, they were completely being demonized and said that they're doing this. The same argument kept repeating, and I think it's very important that, you know, we take stock of it and also see the many ways in which this the problem with I think the RSS kind of discourse is also that when they keep repeating it in all kinds of media here, there, it becomes a part of everybody's discourse. Because yesterday the Kerala High Court actually has given a ruling that a marriage is not something about just the two people who can be majors, they can be adults, but the parents have to play, they have a right or a say in the marriage of their children. And this is the High Court. And this is in a country that has a constitution that respects people's choice. I mean, you have your right to life, you have your right to making decisions, you have your right to religion. But this is a High Court that says, well, parents have a say. And the High Court also says that childish or immature activities, you know, talking about love in the larger context. And I'm really most annoyed, because this is some news that, you know, came very late last night. But the fact is that Kerala is possibly has consistently shown itself as progressive. It was the first state in India to democratically elect a communist government. And when you have this kind of a history and this kind of the court is again, you know, it's just becoming so normal for the court to speak, you know, do this exact Hindutva speak, this speak of, you know, protectionist discourse, this the speak of, you know, parents having a say. And this is not the first time. I think, again, when we look at what this love jihad scare, in 2009, there were two cases that came up before the Kerala High Court, where there were girls who were Hindus. One girl was Hindu, one girl was Christian. They had married Muslim men separately, but in both the cases they sent the girl back to the parent. The girl said, no, it was my own choice, I decided to marry him. The court said, no, go back to your parent. And against her wishes, saying that you stay there for 6 months and let's see if you change your mind. And in 2012, Dharmapuri, the same thing happened. This girl Divya had married Ilavarasan, and she was asked to be produced in court by her parents, so she was produced in court. And the judge, without asking her, without consenting her, said, now go and live with your parents. If your love for your husband is all that strong, you will still get back to him. So the court ordered her to go and live with her parents. But unfortunately, what happened was that Ilavarasan, being a very young person and also under extreme stress, one really even doesn't know what's the end of the story, but the official version is that he committed suicide by falling on the railway tracks. But Dalit groups, as well as Ilavarasan's father, believe that he was murdered. And they repeatedly sought 2-3 postmortems. Nothing came out of it. But what I'm trying to say, it's not about Ilavarasan's death, or it's not about Divya's, what decision she took. But the fact is that this is how the court was functioning. The court decides to imbibe this Hindutva. The court decides to say, okay, this is a Hindu girl. This is a caste Hindu girl. And the functional word is not Hindu. The functional word is also caste. So, okay, go back to your parent. And so far they were only doing it in practice. So every single case, they would just say, okay, send them back to the parent. But now they said, okay, parents have a say in marriage. I don't know what this holds out for all of the Hindu girls, but it's not the most nice thing to know. And again, I think the court also used the word Indian culture about when it wanted to frame this talk about what rights parents have and what rights parents don't have. And I think this Indian culture is again something that's most vexing, because one is that while we don't have any homogeneous idea of Indian culture, Hindutva has made it as the shorthand by invoking the word Indian culture to basically invoke everything that can run against any feminist interest. So Indian culture becomes the word that tells you how to dress. Indian culture becomes the word that tells you when you should be back home. Indian culture is the word that tells you who you should date, when you should date, when you should have children, whether you should have children at all. So, and I think the whole idea of Indian culture is that the dangerous implication is also because just as I was telling you about this Kerala High Court order today, last week there was the circular from one of the most popular universities in Tamil Nadu, which is the Vellore Institute of Technology. So they sent out a whole circular saying that there have been instances reported on the campus, la 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 la. We want all our students to avoid any kind of physical contact except handshakes. And this so that, no, seriously, I'm not joking, this was a circular dated 26 February. They said this is because we want to protect Indian culture and we don't want to give a bad name to Indian culture. So I think that, you know, this whole, just because, even though Indian culture might have been a brainchild of Hindutva, it really appeals to the conservative elements all across society. It appeals to feudal elements all across society. It appeals to the moral police everywhere. And even if they might not patently identify themselves with Hindutva, this is the kind of effect that it has in society. So, yeah, thankfully London School of Economics is situated in London, but I think if you were in Tamil Nadu, you would possibly at some stage be asked to refrain from all physical contact except handshakes. And I also think that the problem is that instead of, you know, being on the fringe or being seen as something that's, you know, extreme, it has now seeped so much, and I'm talking about what you've been seeing like in the last 10 or 20 years, it has now become the new normal. So, you know, an educational institution can actually put out this kind of circular, they can actually, you know, or a court can actually say parents have a say, and or a caste Hindu party can openly say, no, this is what the men are doing. So I think it's just something that's becoming also all-pervasive. And even as we talk about this, I also want to, you know, bring in something about two states of India which are not on the national radar as much as they should be, because India has a tendency of, you know, most of the time India stops at Delhi. Sometimes it goes a little farther down, maybe Maharashtra, maybe Mumbai, but just Kerala and Tamil Nadu totally forgotten, because the last 2 months I was spending in Kerala, and towards the end of January, the beginning of February, there were two massive meetings. There were flags like every not even three foot distance, but you had these flags of the BJP or its allies that was just crowding all of Thiruvananthapuram, all these so-called Marxist bastions. And the BJP is striking two major alliances. One is with the Pulayar Mahajana Sabha, which is this Dalit party. And the other is with SNDP Yogam, which is Sri Narayana Guru Dharma Paripalana Yogam. And so both of, I'm sorry, you know, BJP's electoral politics might not be my business, but as a feminist, I'm really worried, because if you look very closely at the history of the Pulayar Mahajana Sabha, which is untouchable party which was started by Sri Ayyangali, he was somebody who was fighting for the rights of Pulayar women. Pulayar women were asked to bare their breast every time they came across somebody of the higher caste. They were women who were forced to wear earrings made of stone, so that you looked at these women and you knew what caste they belonged to. They were made to, you know, wear stone, they were made to, you know, show themselves naked. And Ayyangali was working among these women, telling, you throw away these stone earrings now, you throw away these symbols of your oppression in a public meeting, and you're never going to, you know, undress yourself, because that's what custom demands. And the same way you have Sri Narayana Guru, who is not a leader of the Dalits, but a leader of the Irawa community, which is a very backward community. And he was not only fighting for rights, but he was also fighting for reform within Hinduism. He was fighting for the rights of, you know, women of the Tiya community, women of the Irawa community. So what exactly happens to all these struggles when, you know, there is this extreme posturing, when these leaders are so happy with Modi's presence? And I think it's so, even though it's, you know, could be electorally strategic for the parties concerned or whatever it is, I think from the position of women, from the position of empowerment, from the position of what these organizations stood for, what these leaders stood for, I think it's undermining this decades of hard work that has been put forward. Or when I come back to Tamil Nadu, which is a state where we believe that the BJP cannot ever take a foothold, not only because of Tamil Nadu's own history of anti-Brahmin movements or the Dravidian movement or the self-respect movement, but initially, you know, it started out with Praveen Togadia, who was going to come, the BHP's president, who was going to come and not just come and speak, but he wanted to distribute Trishuls in Madurai. These are the Trishuls we are talking about, Trishul being something not really known to Tamil Hinduism or Bhakti Hinduism or whatever exists down south. So he wanted to distribute Trishuls. And at the time there was this huge outrage. They were all NGOs who went to court trying to prevent his coming, and so much of this was happening. But again, as somebody from the lower community caste, as somebody who's a woman, what has to be looked very keenly here is that Togadia is not coming to some Brahmin meeting, Togadia was not coming to some Dalit meeting, Togadia was coming and aligning with the Deva community. The Deva community, just like the ideal Hindutva, is a caste Hindu community which relies and takes its pride from its hyper-masculinization, which takes its pride from the kind of riots that it can call at a second's notice, and whose masculinization doesn't stop only, you know, in terms of talk, but also is represented extremely on Indian Tamil cinema. And so he was distributing Trishuls to some community which was already, you know, just trigger hungry, and just willing to wait for the first chance of anti-Dalit violence. And this was, I don't think it was accidental, it was very, very, very pre-planned and cleverly handled. And in the same manner, last year, in December, when Modi was there in Tiruchi, which again is the place where Periyar based himself and did most of his work from, Modi decided, very surprisingly for everybody, to talk about the beheaded or heads of Indian soldiers, apparently by Pakistani army, and saying we should demand these heads back. One, it sounds from the outside that why would anybody talk about, you know, the Indian army coming to Tamil Nadu? Because Tamil Nadu, until the late 60s and for the early part of 70s, was strongly seeking to secede from India. You had the secessionist movement where everybody, you know, my mother, my father, anybody, everybody had this whole anti-Hindi, anti-Indian sentiment. And up to the 1980s, 1990s, you had strong militant groups which were actually working for this. So why would somebody go and invoke the Indian army there? Or was this part of the whole grand, you know, national unification project? I just don't want to comment about it, but the reason I'm trying to, you know, put this in perspective is because and a week after Modi, there's another BJP leader who visits Tamil Nadu and says, just as it's music to Tamil ears, we will get you Tamililam, you guys deserve Tamililam. And, you know, which is the separate state that Tamils in Sri Lanka are fighting for. And it was not Modi, it was, one of the Sinhas was the BJP. And I think this kind of an argument is very nice for them to come and say this, because Sri Lanka, which as you all know, maybe 100,000 people lost their lives in the genocide in 2009, they are trying consistently to appropriate it as a Hindu project, Hindu right project. They are trying to say what all the Tamils there were, they are Hindus. Well, the Tamils never identified themselves strictly as Hindus. The movements that were fighting on the ground never wanted to, you know, affiliate themselves on any kind of religious basis. They were Tamil Hindus, but they were Tamil Christians as well. In fact, the primary time when we all know the situation was going worse was when the Madhu church was occupied by the army, by the Sri Lankan army. So they were Tamil Christians, they were Tamil Hindus, but they want to show this as a kind of, this happened to Tamil Hindus, and the state at the center is not bothered about you because it's a Hindu problem, you know, the Congress, and it's Hindu girls who got raped, and see, nothing happened because it was Hindu girls. And the whole idea in which one struggle and one people is, you know, very conveniently hijacked, and the whole language of the struggle is, you know, modified to suit Hindutva agendas, and then issues of justice to Tamil women suddenly gets boxed into this Hindu women box because it's very comfortable for the BJP. I think all these are issues that today they are, you know, just slightly rearing their head. And, you know, sometimes the trouble is that when it's in its initial stage, you really can't see it, but when it becomes much more, we cannot even spot it. And it's also not about, you know, only these kind of, you know, Tamil Nadu or Kerala things, but also for instance, when Section 377 came, I mean, we're all talking about women, but I think the major talk on gender should also involve talk on homosexuality and how does the BJP look at it. And the whole idea was this, quote unquote, Western culture is being brought into our society and culture, and saying that we are behind the Supreme Court line and it's an unnatural act. And this is what the BJP was saying. So at no point of time was it even willing to reach out to, you know, anything that disturbs safe binary of the masculine, hyper-masculine male and the subservient, wife-bearing, Sita type of Indian woman. And the problem is that when you raise these questions, whether it's, you know, in a kind of academic discussion, I will take my 5 minutes. Is that, you know, the problem is whether you talk about religion or clothing or public space or sexual freedom, and the immediate label in which people are going to shut you down is by saying, oh, she's a Western feminist, and that's exactly why she's talking. I don't know how I became Western feminist, but that's not only me, but anybody who raises these issues is immediately given the glorious stamp of Western feminism. And since I've been given this 5 minute note, I just finished about Modi, who is and his opinion on women. He was the person who actually went on record saying, Dr. Kalpana was citing the statistics about 44% or one in every third child in Gujarat being malnourished. And Modi's solution to that, not explanation to that, was women are not eating because they are beauty conscious. It's the exact word of figure conscious. So this is the man who's going to leave India. I mean, God forbid he gets elected. When you have 6.13 lakh children who are malnourished in Gujarat and 85,000 of them in the capital Ahmedabad alone. And also he is the same person in a country rankled with dowry deaths and female infanticide, when Gujarat has a sex ratio of 917 as opposed to the national average of, very proud national average of 940. He was the man who said, on the occasion of your daughter's birth, you have to plant 5 trees. Because then when your daughter is old enough to be married, you can use these trees and, you know, get her off married. And so this is his, you know, plan, his cottage industry plan for women. So this is the second thing. And third is that never forget, I'm not talking anything personal, but never forget that when he fancied a woman, he had her stalked. He had her phone conversations recorded and all her movements were, you know, like kind of under surveillance. So this is not somebody who should be in charge of a whole nation of women. And again, this again was pointed out by Dr. Kalpana Wilson, who spoke about the fact that his women and children's welfare secretary was Maya Kodnani, who personally oversaw the riots. And even though Indian judicial system is something I have no hopes in, which is never convicted, managed to convict this woman for 28 years for the gruesome death of 94, the gruesome killings of 94 people in Gujarat in 2002. And finally, at the risk of sounding very partisan, I just want to say that Modi, when he was speaking in 2012 April at the Brahmin Sammelan, said, Brahmins, because you know the problem is Indian culture, Brahmins are the custodians of Indian culture and Shastras, and he praised them for this culture. So in case anyone has assumed that Indian culture was some nice fancy hybrid, it's nothing but Hindutva. And Hindutva in turn is nothing but Brahminism. And Brahminism is nothing but a hatred of the outsider, the subordination of the lower caste, and the practice of untouchability, and the enslavement of women. And all of this is not Meena Kandasamy saying, it's Dr. Ambedkar. So thank you very much.